Great podcast.
All right, I think we're almost live here. I just want to get confirmation. Yeah, we're live. All right. Beastly Thoughts, episode 101. What is that thing? That looks like an evil Pokemon.
That's what my daughter thought. It's actually Kyuubi. It's the Jinchuriki that has inhabited Naruto. And it's a collector's item at GameStop. These are pop figures. These are like little collectibles.
Uh-huh.
They're really popular right now. There's actually the Naruto figure.
So oh, okay. I saw these. Yeah, two I've seen those like square-headed pop vinyl things.
That's cool.
Yeah,
that's
these are pretty awesome. And I actually got a new little setup. I did my new gaming setup video yesterday.
Oh, so, nice. Is it live?
Yeah. It's going to be live tonight. I did.
All right, I've told you guys I have like kind of a thing for gaming setup videos. I don't know what it is. I can watch anybody's gaming setup video.
Beastly, GameStop has to make money somehow, though, right?
I drove past them this morning, and I saw people going in, and I just threw my thumbs up. But yeah, I did my gaming setup yesterday, and 2016 is looking really, really nice. Got some new shelving, some new cabinets, some stuff to really accent my living room and bring out the Beastly Gamer. So I'm looking forward to that video going up. I rendered 14 yesterday, so that's going to be a busy week. But you guys, know
I don't know how you find the time during the weekend to do 14 videos. It's crazy talk.
I've been doing it like that for the last couple of months. It alleviates the stress of worrying about, you know, the middle of the week. I could actually come home if I see some new news. I could throw it out there, but if I don't, I'm good because I know videos are still going up today. So it works pretty damn good.
That does. I mean, it's smart, no doubt about it. So, yeah. You know, I guess we're going to do like a nice chill opening here. Relax a little bit.
This never happens.
This never happens. Never have a chill stream. What do you guys been playing? Who wants to go first?
I guess I'll go first. So I've been playing one game this week. It's really been the only thing I've been playing, but that's been Far Cry Primal. I've been really enjoying that game a lot. And I was
getting a lot of hate around the internet.
Well, because obviously they're like, it's using the same engine, you know, it's the same core Ubisoft formula, but I have to say I'm really impressed with the game because I love Far Cry 3. That is a phenomenal game. It was an amazing game. I loved it. Far Cry 4 is more of the same, still great. This is like something different, though. This is really cool because you don't see many games set in the prehistoric era in the Stone Age. Like, this is awesome. I'm really enjoying it.
All right, so what is it about it that you like? I mean, obviously there's no guns. You're running around, what, with like stone axes and rocks?
Yeah, you have literally just three weapons. You have a bow and arrow, you have a spear, and you have a club. That's it. Like, you just go around whacking people with sticks. It's just fun. Like, it's
how's the bow and arrow mechanic? Because I love bow and arrows in games, especially Tomb Raider.
It definitely feels very similar to 3 and 4 because obviously it is the same core engine and it is the same core gameplay, but of course you don't have any guns, so the combat is much harder too because you have to walk up to people and just whack them with like a wooden stick. It's so fun though. I just love doing that. And then of course when you're hunting an animal, you'll be like crouching in the grass and you'll throw a spear at it, then you go skin it. Like, it's just a lot of fun. I'm loving it.
Sounds good. That was a game I was actually thinking about picking up. I knew that it was going to be a big deal, and then slowly the reviews started to roll out, and maybe it wasn't as big a deal as I may have hoped.
Yeah, and of course, a lot of people are going to say, you know, it is sort of still the same thing again. I would have to disagree, because I think I love the new setting they have here. I think it introduced a lot of cool mechanics. Like, I love being able to tame beasts, like the saber-toothed tiger, and you can ride them. That's fucking awesome. I love that. Like, that's so cool.
When you put it like that, it does sound pretty cool.
Yeah, you can ride into battle and just, like, throw spears at guys. Like, it's fucking awesome. It's so cool. And you can even ride, like, woolly mammoths and stuff like that once you unlock the skills. I mean, I just love the setting of this game. It really makes everything and makes what the game what it is. The story itself isn't really that great. You know, it's kind of your standard whatever. And no one speaks English. They're all speaking their own tribal ancient language, but overall, yeah. I mean, I'm really impressed with this game. I expected it to be more of the same, but it's definitely
How would you compare it next to Far Cry 4?
I would say I like this better because it's less of a reskin than Far Cry 4 was. I can appreciate what they've done here, and I think just having that creativity to do something different that a lot of developers don't do, I think it's awesome, and I think it works. And, of course, some of the missions are kind of repetitive because it's that same Ubisoft formula. You know, you're literally like checkboxing a map. That's what you're doing, basically. You're completing every mission. You want to unlock the map. You want to capture the bonfires. It's still a lot of fun, but I'm really enjoying it.
Nice. Sounds awesome.
Really good game. I put 14 hours in, I'd say, by now, and I'm still enjoying it.
Sometimes a game, the setting alone is good enough to keep me playing. I think that the first Assassin's Creed, like, that setting was so original for me, and, like, there's so much to that game that was, like, fresh and brand new that I was able to forgive a lot of flaws. You feel like any of that kind of stuff is hitting you?
Yeah, I mean, I think, honestly, like, they nailed it. This does feel like something different, and it feels like a prehistoric game. Just everything from the sounds to the weapon design to the character animations, like, it feels, you have your own sort of tribal village, too, you can build up, and, like, you have to craft your own weapons as well, so you have to, like, go find sticks and rocks, you have to scrap those items, and then you craft spears from that. Like, I think that adds to the immersion of feeling like this is a prehistoric game where it's really tough. Like, you literally just have sticks and rocks to defend yourself. There are no guns, there are no bombs, there's nothing like that. It's all ancient technology, and it all works wonderfully, though.
Any multiplayer?
No, it's just single player. Open world.
Well, Robbie, you've laid to rest whether or not this game is engaging or not. I don't know anybody personally who has it, but now that I do, I may actually give it a try. Is this the only game you've been playing all week, you said?
Yeah, and I mean, the game has its flaws, of course. Like, it is, once again, very similar just in the fact of what you're doing. You're just checkmarking a map, but the way they executed it is great, and I really enjoy it a lot. And I've just been playing this pretty much.
It sounds interesting enough for me to pick up when it's like $20.
Yeah.
I think I'm going to wait. I'm going to wait on it. It does sound interesting, but I think I'm going to hold off on it.
Yeah.
Maybe I'll put it on the shelf next to the unopened copy of Fallout 4 I have, or not Fallout 4, Far Cry 4.
Far Cry 4.
Yeah.
No,
for me this week in gaming has been pretty insane. I picked up a few games. Sony had a really nice sale on the PlayStation Store, so I got Everybody's Gone to the Rapture. I bought The Walking Dead: Michonne. I haven't played that yet. I bought Metal Gear Solid V, The Phantom Pain.
Ooh, I saw that you were playing that the other day.
Yeah, well, it might be the most beautiful game I've ever seen. I haven't really gotten into it. It's one of those things where you know that once you cross a line, you can't go back. And so I'm trying to tie up some loose ends in gaming before I get into it, because I also bought Hotline Miami 2, which is my new addiction. Hotline Miami, I swear, man, is one of my favorite games, especially on the go on the PSP. It's just such a magical game. The atmosphere of the game, the sound of the game, all that works so well. And I wouldn't think that it would be that, I guess, enthralling to me. But it's one of my wife's in there playing it right now. It's one of those games that once you start playing, you're like, oh my God, this is so crazy. It's so amazing. So I'm playing.
Did you end up beating Hotline Miami?
Yeah.
Okay. So like the story in that is kind of,
it's hit or miss.
There's more to meet than meets the eye in the story on that. Are you enjoying the story in Miami too?
Hotline Miami 2 is kind of a prequel in its own way.
Is it a prequel?
Yeah, it explains a lot of the story of Part 1 and some of the characters that you meet in Part 1. But Part 2 is kind of updated every aspect of Part 1 that I love. One of my favorite soundtracks now is Hotline Miami. I'm starting to say the same thing about Part 2. I jam it at work. When I'm driving around town, I got it blasting out the windows. People are like, what the hell is wrong with you?
Wow.
I'm really into it. But I've also been playing some PC stuff. I've, of course, been playing Blade and Soul. My wife and I have still been playing that and enjoying it. And we just started getting into DayZ. I didn't know on Steam. Well, on Steam, you're supposed to be able to share your account. But for some reason, DayZ, they took that ability away. And so I had to buy it again for her, which is somehow still pre-alpha, beta, state, whatever it is. It's not really a complete game. But I bought it again for her, so we're really starting to get into that. I don't know what it is, man. I just feel like now that I got this insanely powerful PC, well, compared to what I used to have, that PC gaming...
PC Master Race! Yeah.
Shut up.
Yeah, it's nice to get a hot new PC and then run a game that looks like trash on it, isn't it?
Yeah, well, that's why I play Blade, that's why I play Blade and Soul, too. Blade and Soul doesn't look like trash. But when you play DayZ on its highest settings, man, it does look pretty damn good.
Don't forget Windows 8.
Where are they with DayZ right now? Like, are they?
I don't know.
Are they still actively developing it? It's still in beta or alpha, right?
The reason why they could call it the beta or alpha is the reason they're doing it on purpose, so they don't have to fully fix the game. So they, if there's something broke with it, well, it's still a beta, you know?
don't worry about it. It'll get fixed at some point.
In my opinion, if you start charging money for a game, you got to take that beta tag off. Like,
well,
I think it's unfair.
Well, sometimes it works and sometimes it doesn't, because another game I got this week was Street Fighter V.
Mm-hmm.
And that game is pretty much a beta. I got into it. I played Inner Black Ninja yesterday. We played.
How'd that go? I want to hear the gory details.
Uh-oh. Here we go.
Well, he's not here to defend himself.
Well, he can come back next week. I'm not going to dog him because he's my homie.
No, dog him. Dog him. This is the good stuff.
Let's shit all over him.
Well,
no, I'm just kidding.
I'm actually waiting for Not Too Nerdy because that's the one I want to dog. Okay, because he's been talking shit in games for years, and I've never had a chance to play him at all.
It has been like 2 years that he's been talking shit for.
He said Mortal Kombat 2.
Mortal Kombat 2, Mortal Kombat 3, Marvel vs. Capcom 2, Street Fighter, Tekken, I'll dog you in all.
Marvel vs. Capcom 3 as well. Okay.
But, you know.
What I love about you, Beastly, is your humility.
I'm such a humble person.
It's getting real.
Justin, Inner Black Ninja, was, you know, he's a good gamer, and he was talking some stuff to me. He said how good he was in Street Fighter. And, of course, I took it with a grain of salt because I actually honed my skills in fighting games before I really got into any other genres.
Uh-huh.
One of my best friends, his name is Sid Kidd. He's a pro gamer. He lives in New York. I think, Not Too Nerdy, you might know who Sid Kidd is. He's been to Japan. He's played Soul Calibur, Tekken, Street Fighter, all these games and won awards. He lived across the street from me.
Wow.
And so we all grew up together playing hardcore fighting games, and Justin found out that the hard way yesterday.
Oh, shit. It just got real, didn't it?
Well, he said he was pretty good. And
did you grow up next to any hardcore pro gamers? Not Too Nerdy?
Justin Wong. I'm saying, though, like, don't forget, like, I live close to the A and the Break the whole time. A and the Break's, like, the spot that people still go to for competition, stuff like that, before they go to Evo. I'm just saying, though, with your internet connection, I got nothing to worry about.
That's true.
Anyway, Justin, we got
Kato by his internet.
He often does during the show.
We got into, I think we had 11 matches. Now, I played with Ken. Justin, he also said Ken was one of his favorite guys. I ended up winning 10 of the 11 matches. And the one that I lost, I'm not going to take it away from him because he did win it, but I accidentally chose Dalson, someone who I don't play with. But that was still a close match, too.
He's very advanced in his game, though. If you know, like, his skills right now, like, the new features he has, Dalson, like, he's insane because he could teleport, like, the way he teleports is different now. You can cancel out your teleport, which you couldn't do sometimes before. So, like, now it's very advanced. So if you want
to... If you use that teleport, you think you'll be able to beat me?
Well, depends, because you use that for separation. Depends on what character you like to use.
Is it like Akuma's, teleport? Something like that?
Because Dalsum, you can cancel so while you're in there, during a super, you can cancel, like, right away with your teleportation. So, like, you could choose to go in front or behind a person. And no. you could, that's the thing, that you could confuse a person, do mix-up and cross-ups like that.
To finish my little story on Street Fighter, I'm going to just end it by saying that Street Fighter, fundamentally, the way the game plays, the way it controls, and the way it feels, is a 10. Once you're in a match, you're playing with people, there's very little latency or lag. The way that the characters are controlled feels very, very good. It's one of the best feeling Street Fighters I've ever played. That is probably the only really, really good thing about it, other than the fact that the game is stunningly beautiful. The characters, the models all look phenomenal, but the network is atrocious. It takes forever to find a match. There is no story mode, which to me is a big no-no in any Street Fighter. And when you're doing versus modes, there's still no option to play against a non-player character or a PC opponent. So it's I guess, in the future going to get to where it needs to be, but right now I definitely don't think it's worth $60, but
I hope it sells well enough now that Capcom thinks it's worth it to keep developing that game.
Mm-hmm.
I'm a little scared, right? Because, like, right now I'm not buying that.
Yeah,
in the state it's at. I'm not going to go online and play multiplayer or competitively.
That's the worst part of it. You can only play online.
I mean, I'm just waiting for them to finish it. But what if it doesn't sell well enough that they decide, well, we're not going to finish it because nobody's buying the damn thing?
Well, that would be horrible.
I still think they're selling well. Even though people said they didn't download as much PC versions, because that was some other news, the PC downloads weren't as high as the Capcom thought. But mm-hmm. I think a lot of people bought on the PS4. And I have a feeling there's, once the tournament scene comes out, once you see people at Evo and stuff like that, that's when people just purchase the games. So their goal is pretty much to make sure it's finished with those big events where people actually watch it. Because that's when really people buy these fighting games anyway. Can they see other people fight, or they hear about it, and they're like, oh, I want to try that game. And by then, that's pretty much your goal to completely finish it anyway. So, I mean, Yeah, I mean, they took a risk releasing it early, but they asked people first, the fans.
Yeah, they did. That's the one thing that they did do. They didn't just put the game out and say, oh, there's no modes. They actually asked people, hey, look, the game isn't complete. Would you rather us release it now with certain modes and then kind of put the others in later? And the people did speak and say, yeah. So.
Okay, so I know this goes against something I said about 5 minutes ago, but what if they had put it out and just said beta on it, right? Like, this is the beta version of the game. You know, when you if you buy this, you're going to get the rest of it as it comes out. But if they just, you know, because if you follow, like, say you follow IGN or, like, the big gaming websites where you're going to find this news out, you know, you're going to know about this. But if you're just walking into a GameStop and you say, oh, shit, the next Street Fighter is out. And you bring that home, you're going to be sorely disappointed.
Yeah.
I mean, if you're used to what you got in the package with Street Fighter 4 or even way back with, like, Street Fighter 2. It's disappointing.
I think the same amount of content.
Yeah. I don't think anyone would care as much if the network is flawless. And that's the thing. Like, the fact that it is a flawless is why people are caring about the whole package. But, like, if you look at the beta, like, it makes no sense because they had alphas and betas for this Street Fighter V, and those are flawless. Like, the network didn't fail or anything for the most part, you know? There was hiccups, but that's expected of beta. And then this came out, and this actually went down for they pulled it off for like a while on purpose just so they could fix things because it was just too much. It made no sense, to be honest with you, because the beta was so perfect compared to this.
That's so weird that it would go downhill after the beta.
No idea. Happen. So
wow. All right, well, is that it, BC? You've been playing anything else?
Oh, have I? I've been playing Street Fighter 4 on my new 3DS. I got a new 3DS.
I didn't even know Street Fighter 4 was out for 3DS.
Yeah, and it really is awesome. I got
a new 3DS or the new 3DS?
I got the new 3DS itself.
Yeah. Which one
the
is
new
it?
New. With a little gray analog nub that doesn't do anything.
Okay.
Yeah, my 3-year-old broke my 5-year-old's 3DS because that's what kids do. So I gave Nova my red 3DS and went and got myself a big, beautiful gray one, and I just needed something to put on it. And I'm really surprised at how beautiful Street Fighter 4 looks and plays on that thing. It's unbelievable.
Is it 3D graphics or is it?
It's in 3D, but the thing is, it has every character and stage from the PS3 and the Xbox 360 versions. The characters look very similar, very close to the console counterparts, but they also included this kind of a third person mode where you can play against the computer or other players at a 3D angle, so you're kind of behind the character.
Oh, that's cool.
And yeah, I was like, holy shit, what's going on here? I thought that was the only way, but that's like an extra.
It's not as cool as first person VR Tekken, but you know, start.
No. not quite. No.
Yeah, I'm gonna Amazon the shit out of that. I would love to be able to sit there like while I'm watching TV, play a little Street Fighter on my DS.
Yeah, man, it's really slick. I actually got it from this pawn shop. You know, they still exist. They're like GameStops. But I walked in there, and I was getting an oil change next door, so I always walk in there and see what they have. And they had a handful of 3DS games, and I got 3 or 4 of them for $3 a piece.
Nice. GameStop is like a pawn shop now. You go in there, you can buy like used iPods and iPhones and shit. It is like a pawn shop.
They're not. You know what? It's like going into Chuck E. Cheese and trading in something. They give you Chuck E. Cheese coins. GameStop, they're going to give you money that you can use in GameStop. And if it's real money for the real world, they're going to give you $5 for your.
So I've told you guys before, I love my local GameStop, right? It's filled with awesome employees, like really cool guys. When I go in there, I rarely walk out without having at least like a 5 to 10 minute conversation with somebody. Mm-hmm. But in general, I don't have that feeling about GameStop. They're a lot of their policies feel like they're really anti-consumer, right?
They're a bit of a robotic corporation.
Yeah. And I haven't actually been to a GameStop. I feel like it's 6 months or something like that. It's
been
a long
crap,
time.
What's going on here?
I've started buying the games off the console just because it's so much more convenient just to have them there. And, you know, I understand that it's not as good a value because, you know, I'm not getting that, you know, if I stop playing a game, I'm not getting that return. But, man, it's just so convenient to have the game just installed on the hard drive.
You just broke my heart.
Amazon, because Amazon Prime, you get 20% off right away for all new games, new releases.
That's awesome.
So, like, automatically it's 20% off. You're starting out cheaper for the game. So, and it's delivered on release day for you. Like, you really can't beat that. Like,
well,
goodbye.
I had this really bad thing happened with me in PlayStation Network. My bank, Chase Bank, sent out these new debit cards. So if you had the old debit card, they gave you a few months before you had to actually activate the new one. It has a new chip inside
Everybody's
using. Yep. And so I waited till the last fucking day. And finally, I changed it over, and I went to the PlayStation Store, and it won't work. For some reason, with PlayStation only, my PayPal doesn't work, the card doesn't work, my wife's card doesn't work. And, of course, I called Sony. They were like, are you sure your addresses are the same? I said, I didn't change anything. I just activated the card. So now I go to GameStop to buy my PlayStation Network cards, and that sucks.
Yeah,
that but my GameStop is right literally across the street. So
back in the old days, that was another good way of getting those points was ordering those cards off of Amazon. There was always a discount on there. I don't know if that still happens. Xbox Live cards, I used to get a ton of those things off of Amazon. It was like a 15 or 20% discount.
All right, so we're continuing on with what you've been playing, Mr. Not Too Nerdy Entertainment. What you've been playing all week?
Blade and Soul, for the most part, that's a game that, you know, I've been continuing trying to level up my character. I've been working around with, like, Twitch a lot, so trying to get my Twitch to be, like, a really good stream. Okay, I never really tweaked everything since I built my new PC. Now I have, like, even faster internet than I had before. So, like, I never really tweaked everything together.
Wait, what?
Holy shit.
My upload speed is quicker than it was before by, like, about, I say, 30 megabits higher, like, upload. So, like...
Whoa.
It's pretty high, like fast wise. So like I'm trying.
Who are you blowing at your local internet?
What's going on?
So like I was trying to get this.
Who are you giving favors to, Hector?
Because I never really did that where you're supposed to tweak it out between your graphics card, your CPU usage, and also the bit rate, everything. I actually tweaked it out and actually had the right settings for once. The only thing that it's funny because. The easy part was the settings, and then all of a sudden my audio and everything was just completely off, and I was trying to fix everything.
Are you using OBS?
Yeah.
OBS, it confuses the hell out of me sometimes. Like, it'll work, and then something doesn't work, and I'm like, nothing changed, man. What's going on?
And then it just crashes randomly, too. That's the worst.
Yeah.
Oh, my God.
I literally tweaked everything out, so, like, I have my... Twitch overlay for once. Now I actually have a good overlay there. I have like the spot for my webcam with my overlay for streaming. I also have, in case someone does subscribe or like someone follows or anything and it makes an announcement, I have like Carlton Banks dancing and stuff and does like different celebration stuff when someone does it. So like I actually set up the whole thing, so I want to start streaming a lot more on Twitch and then posting some of it on YouTube.
Is twitch.tv/not too nerdy?
Not too nerdy, yeah. It's just not too nerdy on that. So that one right there. So that, I'll start streaming a lot more games now. I also played Super Hot. I don't know if you guys heard about that game. That game, Super Hot, is super fun. I'm not gonna lie. Like, if you guys don't know what that is, it's a first-person game. It is first-person shooter. You know, you don't start out with a gun. You do have to pick up the gun at certain points and different weapons, but your objective is to kill enemies with a certain amount of time. The difference is nothing moves until you move. So, like, they might have fired a bullet, but the bullet doesn't move until you move, until you take a step. So you have to plan out, are you going to go left, right, straight? Like, you have to plan out your moves in slow motion.
This PC?
So, yes. So it's PC and Linux, if you have Linux. Anyone?
Anybody? Anybody? Bueller?
Anyone in the chat? No, definitely not.
But that game is a lot of fun. If you haven't played it before, or you definitely check it out. It's a lot of fun. You know, it's something different, I think, because it's supposed to be supported by Oculus. So that would be amazing to see the bullet when you turn to the side.
That would be super cool.
That would be pretty cool. So, so that's pretty much all I've been playing.
This game kind of got shown like a couple of years ago. I saw it like on YouTube like for the first time. Like one of the guys I subscribed to for some reason had an early version of it, and it just looks so cool.
Yeah,
I can't wait to play this. I didn't realize it was out. It's only going to be PC though. They're not going to bring it out for consoles.
From what I heard, it's only PC. I'm not too sure. I mean, so someone could correct me if I'm wrong with that, where it's going to come out. But I know it's PC right now. It came out on the 25th, so that's not too long ago. Let me look it up real quick.
Super Hot.
Wow, I'm wrong. It says that it's also going to be Xbox One. Did it come out for Xbox One already, too? Huh.
I don't know.
Maybe I don't know. Wikipedia is wrong. I bet that wouldn't be the first time, but it says Xbox One though. Oh, it says
Beastly
okay.
Thoughts facts coming at you.
I got it. It says right here Xbox One in Q1 2016. So okay. that part didn't come out yet, but so far it's also for Mac and Linux. So Mac's
it there. Says the release date says February 25th.
Yeah.
It says February 25th, 2016.
For nice. Not for Xbox One.
Yeah, well, that's what it says here for Xbox One.
Oh, it says Q1 on. Okay, I don't know.
That would be considered Q1.
Yeah, I didn't hear anything about Xbox. I didn't even see one person play Xbox One version. Online anywhere. So unless
I might have to try that out, man.
Yeah.
The game is super cool looking. I haven't played it, but I'm glad you're saying it's good. I like that kind of style it has too. Like the
looks
black
like
and the white
sterile,
and the red.
Sterile, like Mirror's Edge or something.
I say good for price range, too. I paid $20 for it. So, price range, that's definitely good.
let me say this, too, Briar. You know, as we are console gamers predominantly, last week I spent quite a bit of time on Steam with Kate, buying games. And a lot of these games, I don't even remember the name because they're like $3, $4, $5.
Yeah.
But you can get a shit ton of stuff for very, very little on Steam.
Right, Steam is amazing.
That's the cool part about PC gaming. It's like the upfront cost is higher than with a console, but the long term cost seems to be cheaper because the games are cheaper.
Yeah. Everyone remember this day when Beastly said that, okay? Because when those sales come in, those summer sales, stuff like that, he's gonna be broke. He's gonna be like, man, I spent so much money on these cheap games.
Yeah, right.
I bought all these games.
Far Cry 4 Primal
play.
For $1.50.
Probably never play it, but at least I got it.
Yes. I have games on my Steam account that I've never played just because they're so cheap on those sales.
I have like 60 games that I've never played.
That's the thing that hurts though, Briar. It's like right now I got Dying Light, I forget the name of it. The new DLC. Yeah, I got that. Never even started it just at all. I got Metal Gear waiting on me, right? And I got this plethora of other games just sitting staring at me. And it does hurt, like deep inside, that they're not getting the attention they deserve. Because I know they're awesome games. And I'm wasting my time. I've been spending a lot less time on The Last of Us. So, yes, I'm the Beastly Gamer. I'm a Last of Us addict. And I've slowed down. But wow. I've been playing lesser-known games and trying to get into other stuff. But that's the thing that bothers me. It kind of hurts. I'm still buying games. I don't have time to play them. But I got to try to make time to play them. But I'm still going broke, Hector.
You know what you got to do? You got to cut down on the amount of time you spend at work and with your family. That's really the key
right.
here.
Fuck them all.
Hey, Beastly, you see, like, I'm a video game collector, but, like, physical copies? I've never really seen a digital video game collector collection.
Let me show you my collection.
You know how much this hard drive is worth?
Yeah. Yeah, I got that 2 terabyte. It'll be delivered tomorrow for my PS4.
Hey, baby, so you want to see that collection of mine?
Nice.
All right, Briar, so nice, what you been playing?
Obviously, Destiny, you know, it's always Destiny for me. This week, the Iron Banner has been around, so I've been... there's a new sniper rifle, the Wailerin's March, which I really have wanted. The way you buy it from Lord Saladin, it kind of sucks that way, so you want to get better perks than that. So I've been playing a lot of Iron Banner, trying to get as many of them as I can to get like that perfect roll. And the amount of network manipulation they've done in Destiny over the last couple of months has really shown. The lag is much less, in my opinion, than it has been in the past. And the PvP side of Destiny is actually looking pretty good. It's much snappier. It feels much more connected than it has in the past. You know, like I don't feel like shots that should have hit are missing as frequently as they used to. So I'm really impressed with that. We also, the Planet Destiny podcast team that I'm a part of, also got to, in a match against the Guardian Radio podcast team, and that was fucking fun. So we played 6v6, had an absolute blast with My Name is Bife, Mace is Sean, all the Guardian Radio guys who were super fun to be around. It was just a really good week in Destiny for me.
I had a question for you, Brian.
Yeah.
Since, you know, you play Destiny a lot, do you notice, like, less people on Destiny? Do you think that's why, like, the servers are, like better? Or do you think it's still the core group, the people that have been there throughout are still there? Or do you feel like it's some people that you've noticed, like, people are leaving or not?
People are definitely leaving, right? There's no doubt about it. Just because it's been so long since we've gotten new content for the game. I don't think that's the issue with their matchmaking. I think they turn up the skill-based matchmaking up so high where it's just so heavily weighted to trying to match you with other players that are the same skill level as you that the connections really suffer because maybe there's not a whole lot of people the same skill level as you in your area. So it starts looking sometimes at different continents. Mm. And that really makes a difference. So over the last couple of months, they pulled back on that some, made it more about connection-based matchmaking. But you can see day-to-day, they seem to be moving it around. Like Bungie went like radio silent in January, and Destiny players got really upset about it. So when they came back, they said, okay, we won't do that again. And so they've been much more communicative about the matchmaking. But it's, you know, they don't share those numbers about how many players there are actively. I can always find a match. You know, like the Destiny subreddit is always filled with people. LFG sites are always filled with people. So, you know, I'm sure that there's less people, but it's definitely not an empty game.
Do you think, like, the type of game Destiny is, do you think they put too much of a gap between new games? Like,
yeah, I do. I do. I think that in the future, I think if I were running Destiny, right, if I were the head of Bungie, I would have a major game release once a year, like they did with Vanilla Destiny, then the Taken King, mm-hmm. and then those gaps would be filled in with two or three DLCs every year. This year, it looks like we're going to get two DLCs overall, and then Destiny 2 is going to come out sometime in 2017. Yeah. Okay. I think that's too far. It's too long, especially for the PvE mm-hmm. guys, like the guys who like killing the minions of darkness who don't necessarily get down on the Crucible. It really feels like a long wait.
And I think
how many times do you want to run the same strike over and over again?
You got to imagine that Bungie is allocating all their resources into Destiny 2. That's what I think they're probably primarily focused on right now. And that's unfortunately why, you know, support for Destiny 1 is dropping, because they want to move on and finish this other game. They want to get it out by next year. I think that's why. I think it's going to be frustrating for a lot of people like you, Briar, who are still enjoying Destiny so much. But that's just development. They got to move on.
I would agree with you. And I'm looking forward to them moving on because there's a lot of things I'd like to have them fix. You know, to get these challenges done with other podcasts, what we have to do is do like matchmaking manipulation.
That's frustrating.
There is no private or custom lobbies in Destiny. So what we do is we're talking to each other through Discord or through Skype or something, and we time the launch button press, you know, 3, 2, 1, and then just hope that matchmaking puts our two teams together. If it doesn't, we back out and try again and try again. When we played Crucible Radio 2 weeks ago, it took 45 minutes just to get the match started. Just because we couldn't get it going, you know? And, you know, that's one of the things that I really hope gets added to Destiny 2, if not to Destiny 1 earlier.
I think since Destiny is such, a trial run for them, because they haven't done a game to that caliber before. I mean, Halo's different, completely different from what they did. Yeah. So, like, maybe Destiny 2 will be all what they know now, like what people want, and put everything together. So I'm hoping, at least, you know, hopefully that's what they can put everything together.
Let me ask you a question, Brad. Scratch.
Yep. We can hear. Go ahead.
Yeah, we can hear.
That was awkward. I didn't understand what's going on.
Let me ask you a question.
Oh, did he drop out? Is he gone?
Oh, he dropped out.
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Oh, great.
I thought he just stopped asking a question. I was like, I was like
what? What happened? I'm
so confused. That thoughtful look on his face, too. Go ahead.
Oh, that audio.
Oh, that's weird. Okay.
Jesus.
He's going to ask me first.
I don't know. Like, they are clearly learning about what that game's going to be. Like, Bungie themselves are learning as they go with that game, right? I mean, the changes they've made since the original release of it to, you know, the Taken King are huge changes, and I wouldn't be surprised to continue to see those changes throughout this year. But I got high hopes for Destiny 2. We'll see what happens.
I hope P versus E, like, you actually have more people go with you, and it could be more people throughout, like, questing and stuff like that. I think that would be something that hopefully they try to do. I know it'd be kind of hard, but they change their format more towards what they're trying to get before, MMO style. That would be kind of interesting if they do that. I know that was one of the biggest complaints, right? Because everyone kept saying it's not a true MMO in that sense. The way you quest is only limited and is sort of linear once you have to do certain things. But, like, I wonder if they're going to take that advice and try to make it more open world, you know.
I'd love that. Even like, more people in patrols – and maybe even like a PvP area in Patrol, like a.
That would be interesting.
Well, here's the thing.
Like an arena or something, like a dynamic one where you kind of just go in and fight each other. That would be neat. Well, and everyone like spectates. That could be cool.
See, Blade and Soul, right? In Blade and Soul, like you go around the world and stuff like that. But if you wear a certain costume that's a P versus P costume, you could get killed by other people in the real world. So like there's real people that will kick your ass. And like I didn't know what was going on until I realized I was wearing a specific costume I'm not supposed to wear because you get your ass whooped. So that would be awesome. Like Destiny had that implemented. So
I don't know what's going on here. Everything's fucked. That's weird. The call just totally fell apart.
What just happened?
The call just like completely fell apart.
Oh, I thought it was me. I'm like, what did I just do?
Yeah, I lost out.
Did you guys get... What just happened, guys?
We're fine.
You hung up, and then we continued going, and I think... Did you try and call me back?
Yeah, I tried to join back in.
Oh, okay. All right.
Yeah. Okay.
We're good.
I'm like, all right, cool.
We're good.
Welcome, episode 101.
Flawless episode, guys. Congrats.
Flawless victory.
It's all good.
Should we do some news?
On that note, news.
News.
We'll have sound effects.
You want to get started while I find out where the last week's news ends and where this week's begins?
Shut up, you guys. Sorry. All right. First bit of news this week is about Fallout 4. Fallout 4 is getting mod support on PC in April through Steam Workshop. Mod support will also be on Xbox One starting May, and then a month later in June for PS4. So finally, mods are coming to consoles. And I'm wondering if developers will follow suit too and start doing this, because I can't wait to see how the mods are going to be on consoles, because obviously you're not going to have those mods that make the game probably look graphically better, because then the frame rate's just going to die down. Mm-hmm. I wonder what they're going to allow. What do you guys think?
Well, inventory management would be huge on my end. I would love to see them fix the inventory.
Yes.
I have a question. Wasn't it only supposed to be Xbox One for mods originally?
No,
it's timed exclusive. That's why it's coming a month later for PS4.
So it's only 1 month time exclusive?
Yeah, 1 month, which isn't enough. It wasn't enough to make a big difference. When I initially heard that news, I was really excited about just getting on Xbox One because of the mods. And then the same day at the Bethesda conference, later in an interview, I forget the guy's name who was on stage for Bethesda, he said, we'd like to do it on PS4 too. So I was like, all right. So 1 month, which probably isn't enough time to sway too many people.
Yeah, not much of a selling point. Honestly, I thought it would be more than this. But
anybody still playing Fallout 4? Are you going to come back to it for this?
No.
I'm kind of curious how this is going to work on console. You know, what route are they going to go out? Are they going to let people sell their mods? Or is it going to be free? Like, how are they going to do this? If they sell your mod, you know, like, does the, you know, PlayStation get a portion of it, you get the rest? Like, I'm kind of curious how they'll let you do mods on that.
And how is the mods going to come through? Like, are you going to be able to literally break the game, like, on PC, which I doubt. I think it's going to be heavily...
It's going to be
Bethesda. They're definitely going to have quality.
They're going to have moderators and people who basically choose which mods would be feasible on the console. They're not going to just let anything through.
It's like having an app store on your iPhone, where you got to like submit it and it gets tested, and then
they're going to have to look through it and make sure it's not going to expose.
Unfortunately, there will be no boobies for Fallout 4 on console.
Damn it! No hot coffee.
Think about it. If you get like kickbacks, something like that, this may change the way things are done on a console. That's why I'm kind of curious to see how they do it. I mean, more than likely they'll screw it up, but I'm saying if they don't screw it up, it could change a lot of things for different consoles, because who knows, you know, like Microsoft or Sony, if they see there might be money in it for them for let people do mods, but they moderate it, like they control it, like how it distributes and stuff like that, they can make a portion out of it, and so could a person. It gives other people opportunity to sit there and try to design the game and fix it themselves.
Yeah, I think there's a lot of potential here. Absolutely. I think this is great, and I hope more developers do this. I'm really excited to see this.
Part of me wants to go back and play Fallout. I probably will at some point, just like The Witcher, which I know is probably a better game overall than Fallout. But, God, it just feels like such a chore. Moving on.
You guys are a bunch of Bethesda haters.
Let's go.
Pre-order Doom on Xbox.
Coming from the guy who literally said, like, the week before this game came out, best game ever.
I still love the game. I wouldn't say it's the best ever, though.
Fall 3 you order Doom on Xbox One, you get the first two Doom games for free with backwards compatibility.
You guys are still
playing. Sweet, you sold me. I'll do it on Xbox for that.
Yeah.
I love Doom.
Love those games.
I'm loving the backwards compatibility anyway on the Xbox One. I just was playing some more, what is it, Gears of War 2. My kids thought it was an Xbox One game. That's how good it looked.
Really?
Wow.
So, you might want to look at an eye doctor for these kids. Some spectacles.
Spectacles.
I think this is really awesome, you know, to give people these free games. I was playing, believe it or not, yesterday for a video I uploaded. I was playing the original Doom on PlayStation 1. And it doesn't stand up graphically, but it brought back that old feeling of nostalgia. So for people who played Doom on PC way back in the day, this might be really, really worth it to pick it up on the Xbox One with that pre-order.
The original Doom, man, is like, it looks so blocky and lame now, but back in the day, man,
it was
an adrenaline-filled thrill ride.
You know, I played yesterday for about 20 minutes. You know, I was doing a story about the new Doom and how Xbox One and PS4 will both have 1080p 60 frames per second. So it's really good news.
Really?
Yeah, both of them will have optimized visuals for the game.
That's and awesome.
I was playing the original, and my family was sitting there looking at it, and I saw my wife. You know, she's 10 years younger than I. She was looking like, what the hell, what is this? And I said, it's Doom, one of the best fucking games of all time. And it still has that, you know, that fun factor. Really, that's all it is. There's no story to Doom. You're just running around with chainsaws and, you know, crazy-ass weapons destroying enemies, but the game does look like Minecraft with guns. You know, it looks really, it does now when you look at it. But it's still very, very fun, man. And for people,
I wonder if anybody's made a Doom Minecraft mod.
They just did it as we spoke right now. As we're speaking right now, someone just made it.
So, Briar, you said this news would sway you to get Doom on Xbox One.
Yeah, why not? Get an extra value for it. I don't know if I'll pick up Doom day one, but I'll definitely pick it up at some point because I'm a big fan of the series.
The thing that shocked me, though, about the little article I did yesterday is that when we saw the early footage of the game, them actually playing at 60 frames, that is console. You know, it's console moving.
60 frames per second is good news. I wonder if there'll be a multiplayer.
Yeah. I mean, they didn't say in the article I read yesterday, but I would hope so.
I would hope so, too. I don't know if there will be.
I actually ordered the collector's edition for PC for Doom.
Yeah?
So that's like...
What comes in the collector's edition?
That is one of the Doom characters. Oh, man, I wish I could show it on the stream, but I can't. But yeah, so there's like a little statue figure, which I, you know, it looks pretty cool. And yeah, you get like a whole bunch of other features. Let me see real quick. Hold on. Let me get all of them real quick.
Is it as cool as the Metal Gear Solid red hand that you got?
No, this is way cooler because it actually has like a... It's LED lit base and everything. So like, and it actually has a slow spinning part. So like it actually moves, which is a step That's up cool. from that freaking hand that doesn't do awesome. Anything. Well, I mean, unless you make it do something, you know what I'm saying?
Oh, yeah. Little tiny hand's probably the right size for you.
Let it give you some favors, you know?
A little Deadpool joke.
Yeah, a little milk in the cow. Yeah.
Right.
Oh, shit. All right. So Sony will be holding a VR press conference during GDC on March 15th.
Hopefully we will
for,
get
for
a,
virtual reality.
Yeah, hopefully we will get a price and release for PlayStation VR finally, because should have happened by now.
I'm more anxious to see the must-have game for VR. That's what I believe that we need to see for this thing to be successful. I mean, they've got some games that they've shown, and the games were kind of lackluster. Come on now. Giant Robot Golf might sound cool in premise. It actually might be fun, right? But they haven't shown me anything that makes me say,
come on, man. What about Job Simulator? Did that not sell you enough?
No, I do that every day for fucking real. I stay at home and play video games.
But now you can simulate it on VR.
No? Now you can do it when you get home, too. It's the best of both worlds.
You'll be working all day, all night.
See, the problem you have, though, it's like... The developers need you to prove like that you could actually you're gonna have enough audiences, right? So they could develop a game. And you have to do reverse. You have to prove to the audience, you know, the buyers, the purchasers that hey, you actually have content for what they're going to buy. So now you're stuck in between where you have to try to force developers to try to do it. That's why they're making deals beyond the scenes to say, like, in order to get a deal for another game, first you're going to have to do this game and something like that, a mini game or something like that, just to show off the machine. And they also force other people that were on the Vita. Some of those developers are now on the VR, you know, so like they push them there. So like you're sort of stuck, and that's the way it's going to be for a while. So when you say must have game,
2 years from now, if we're lucky.
Yeah, because like that's the thing. Like you're looking at, you have to prove that people are going to buy it before they can actually have a game and like a real good game, ones that we want. I mean, you might get something, you know. You might be, I don't know, Mark Cerny hasn't been doing anything for a while. I know Knack 2 is coming out. Maybe Knack 2 could be there. You know what I mean?
VR
I don't
launch know. Title.
What they should have done is got a first-party studio on this, right? Absolutely. Is like developing that game so that it launches with
maybe
the Mario.
They didn't announce God of War? Who knows? What
God of War VR?
God of War VR. Like, I'll be sick, but like, it looks cool.
Hey, Santa Monica's working on the next God of War, and they must be announcing it soon.
I can't picture a VR version of God of War.
Imagine they're ripping guts out. Oh.
First person, too. You get the Switch if you want. Oh my God.
I got to put my smock on. I'm playing God of War. It's like going to a Gallagher show. Farming Simulator 17 has been announced. It will come to any... What the fuck? NES, Genesis, and Apple Macintosh by the end of the year?
PC and consoles, basically. That's what I meant to say.
Okay.
It's coming to the NES, the Sega Genesis, and Apple Macintosh.
No, I'm
what
kidding.
What the hell, man?
I was a troll. Because I knew no one would give a shit, so that's why I put, instead of PS4, Xbox One, PC, I put those.
You're correct. Actually, I think you did the right thing here, Robbie. You put something fun in a story that nobody gave a shit about.
So people give a shit about it.
Next time, right, Noah gives a shit, move on.
See? Uncharted 4's story trailer has debuted, and it comes with a lot of controversy as art from Assassin's Creed Black Flag originally appeared in the trailer. It has since been replaced by an updated version, and the picture has been removed.
Ooh,
I'm wondering what happened here. Like, did they actually take
someone
the art from Phase 4? I don't know.
He copied, because the person that copied was the person that left Assassin's Creed in the first place, and that's the person in charge of the art. So like, he copied, and like, they're trying to say like the story was trying to hit it, like who did it, but like even Ubisoft called them out, the person that did it. So like, they didn't have, I'm guessing, you know, since they're being rushed to do certain parts of the game, like he probably didn't do his own artwork and he put it out there. I wouldn't be surprised he did it on purpose, to be honest with you. It seemed like
a little revenge.
It was right there to be noticed. And it was on a trailer, too. So a trailer is something you review many times before you release it out to the public.
Yeah,
so, like, yeah, so that's something that you see. So they knew for a fact that artwork was there. So, And that's pretty funny, though. I mean, it's sketchy. It's sketchy, but it's funny. I mean,
all right, guys, moving on. Resident Evil 4, 5, and 6 are being remastered for PS4 and Xbox One. They will all be sold separately for $20. Resident Evil 6 will release on March 29th.
Who cares?
Resident Evil 5 will come this summer. And
Still, who cares?
Who cares?
Okay.
Resident Evil 4 kind of will be released this Resident fall, Evil though. 4. Everybody cares about that one.
Yeah.
Resident Evil 4 is the good one, right? Like, everybody likes that game. Everybody hates the other ones. Who cares?
No,
why are they releasing them in reverse order? Everybody but you, Beastly, who is clearly and objectively wrong on this matter.
Yes. Well, the reason that they're releasing them in this order is to keep the excitement up, because they know that they release Resident Evil 4 right now.
Nobody's buying 5 and 6. Nobody gives a shit about those
games.
So
they're trying to make people wait out for 4. Of course, 4 is going to be the last one. And let me just say this as a disclaimer. The reason I like Resident Evil 5, which nobody really cares about, is because I wasn't really big on the internet back then when that game came out. And Kate and I, we played it and beat it over 30 times. Together. I've never played the game single player by myself. I always played with the co-op mode with her. And we had a ton of fun. And actually, when this news came out a few days ago, she was super excited about us playing it again. So
nice.
I mean, it's a game that we kind of built our relationship around years and years ago. We sat for untold hours and beat the hell out of that game, and we had a lot of fun. Now, was it as good as 4? Hell no. It was better than 6 for sure.
what's the actual what's the actual order of like Resident Evil to begin with? Anyone know?
What do you mean?
Like the actual order. Isn't there like is it all
Oh, like the timeline?
Yeah, timeline.
Is it sequential?
That's what I'm saying. It's not sequential. I don't know. I think that's why also in the storyline I think
it's 1-2 Code Veronica.
Yeah.
3.
That's 4. A challenge for the viewers right there. If anyone can figure that out, they get a cookie.
If anybody can Google that, they get a cookie.
Code Veronica was
Let me get on that.
I'm too damn lazy to type. So go ahead.
And you guys let us know in the comments, does anybody like Resident Evil 5, and what was your favorite Resident Evil game?
That's it's 4. We, it's the, it's objectively the best Resident Evil.
Resident Evil 1 Director's Cut.
That was actually pretty damn good.
Director's Cut was. Extra gore really and everything, great. It was.
Resident mm-hmm. Evil 6 Super Deluxe Ultimate Remastered Edition.
Kiss my ass. Turbo. You got to get the turbo.
How do we get
with turbo graphics. There you go.
Really Take good. 2 Interactive is coming to E3 this year, teasing several big game announcements at this year's convention.
Oh, really? That's interesting.
Yeah. I'm going to say right now, Red Dead Redemption 2 is happening. New Bioshock, because if you guys remember, Strauss Zelnick said those are permanent franchises. There's got to be. This has got to be the time
the
where
the Bioshock collection was just announced.
I fucking wait for this. Goddamn. Oh. I can't wait to see announced. That too.
I know that in the news recently, the Bioshock collection just came out. So that's going to happen. Bioshock 1, 2,
and Infinite. What's that? Bioshock 1 and 2 or Bioshock 1, 2?
1, 2, and Infinite. All 3.
Yeah, collection.
By the way, that's... Bioshock 2 was selling for $30 on Steam. I saw like 2 days
that's
ago.
That's way too much.
I was like, what the hell is going on? Like, you're jacked with the price.
On Steam.
I could not believe it. It was like $30 on Steam. It was literally 2 days ago. I saw that and I was just shocked. So. I've seen that, like for $7.
Some famous YouTuber must have started playing it.
Yeah.
Caused a gold rush on it. Like, check it up, check it up.
PewDiePie.
Ooh, this might be actually really exciting for fans of the old COD series. Battlefield 5 will reportedly be set during World War I, according to German retailer.
Yep.
It's been a long time since we had a World War I or World War II game set, you know, in this vein of gameplay, so... I'm really excited.
Yeah, it should be fascinating. You're going to hang out. You're going to get trench foot in this like trench, this muddy trench. You're going to hang out there for the first 4 hours of the game. and then
you're not going to shoot a single person.
The last 10 minutes of the game, the last 10 minutes of the campaign, are you jumping out of the trench, running straight forward, getting caught in some barbed wire, machine gun down, and then you die a slow game and over. Painful death. And then the credits roll.
It's a 4-hour, 10-minute campaign. Yeah. Nick Breyer knows the
Realistically,
whole
Realistically, though... I actually think they did the right move because I see like every game is going futuristic, right? So yeah. I feel like to separate yourself, to go back, you know, back in time is a great idea right now. But then again, it's EA, they're going to fuck it up. So
yeah. It'll ship broken and, broken, you know, it had potential, but it's fucked.
It doesn't
the
matter. Games
I mean, the weapons, like, that's the thing I think that these futuristic shooters don't really grab you with, is, like, the weapons don't feel like anything you're familiar with, so there's no connection there. But if you go backward in time, you know, it's fun to see all the different weapons. You know, you got single load rifles, you know, you got pistols that, you know, only have 6 shots. So the variety of weapons for multiplayer is really fun and really, you know, they all feel different. I think that's one of the things that they get wrong with these future shooters, is that everything is kind of generic.
Right. I want to go back to, like, Civil War time. I want to reload and like, fire.
He's getting ready to fire.
Hurry, quick, fire.
You know, that's all you need. Like, that's all you need, man. Running up, people stabbing them. Like, that's it.
Can you imagine, though, guys, you're in the middle of a firefight, you run up to the enemy, they run up to you, and you both start reloading.
Yeah.
Standing there looking at each other, reloading.
Dude, you bayonet at him.
I'm throwing at someone. Like,
oh shit.
Yeah, man. Like cannonballs just like whizzing by you.
Oh man. All right.
So
I would play that game. That sounds fun.
No one has done that game yet. That's a great idea.
This guy hasn't been mentioned at all today, Robbie. So why don't you get to our last little bit of news?
Dude, he looks like Mario. Looked like my doctor. A couple weeks ago,
damn,
Guy looks like he's looking for a handout. Times are tough for Mario, man. Brother, can you spare a dime?
My 3DS sales are very, very low.
Yeah, that's the news.
Weak 3DS sales have led Nintendo to lower its expected earnings for the current fiscal year.
Ouch.
First time in forever.
Everyone is bothered. It's done well overall for a handheld. You know what I mean? They really milked the crap out of it.
You can't really do much better than this little bastard's done in the handheld space. The 3DS has been kind of, they've cornered the market on the handheld gaming market pretty much. They own it, and you really can't do much better than Nintendo's done with the 3DS. I mean, how many years has the 3DS been on the market? And they're still extremely relevant, selling like insanely. So, I mean, I guess right now it probably is time for them to start thinking about the NX handheld. I mean, it's kind of realistic to see it start to decline gradually after an eon of stellar sales.
How many 3DS have there been models?
Six? I don't know, man. It's a lot.
There's been a lot of them.
New 3DS. There like
the 3DS XL. New 3DS. The new 3DS. The 2DS.
There you go. There are literally five 3DS iterations in my house. I bought Nina a 2DS. Wow. It'll be here tomorrow. I got one. Nova has one. My boys have one. It's just every house has 3D.
Remember the original was like a brick. The thing was horrendously designed.
Yeah.
It wasn't until the light that I really... It kind of thought, okay, I'll buy this.
Mm-hmm. Who remembers that ugly gray Nintendo DS? The original.
Yeah.
I get so confused every DS, ES, LS, PS. Mm-hmm. Like,
I got my Game Boy Micro still kicking it.
you have one, Briar?
Yeah.
Me too. The thing is awesome. And it probably still is charged up.
I will say this, though. I still love that clamshell design on the 3DS, and I hope that they move forward with that because that is very easy to hand over to a kid and not worry about too much because you don't have to worry about the screen getting scratched up. You don't have to worry about it getting damaged.
The SP was the first one to do that?
Yeah.
You just Advance, made me feel bad Advance? About getting my daughter a 2DS. Thanks. Because thank you. He brought it all home, like, really in the back of my mind as he was speaking. I saw screens getting scratched and cracked.
Please let us know in 2 months if you have to buy a new one.
Damn it.
It's okay. People like you keep Nintendo selling the 3DS.
That's the worst feeling, though.
When you're rebuying
a console like right at the end of the generation. I did that with the PS3. Like it was months before, like 2 or 3 months before the PS4 came out. And I'm at GameStop buying a PS3 because mine broke. I was like, oh, this hurts. This hurts bad.
Damn.
And I haven't used it since. I got the PS4. Just sits there.
I use my PS3 every now and then. With the PlayStation Plus stuff, every now and then you want to just see what they got. I log in at least once a month just to get the free games. I'm hoping that the PS5 somehow you're able to transfer all that information over, those games over. You know,
we're talking with the PC architecture. Don't you think that would be more?
Yeah. Should be.
Sony has filed several patents for a glove-type controller, more than likely to be used with PlayStation VR.
Looks exactly like the
Power Glove. The Power Glove returns.
Yes!
I wish I could show the picture. I don't know how to do it on here, though.
Be right back.
Oh.
Yeah, it looks... Well, it was just a drawing of what this thing is supposed to be and what it's capable of, but I covered this, too. It's the Power Glove coming to fruition. Yeah. It's what Nintendo wanted the Power Glove to be.
It'll be much better, too.
But it's actually a virtual reality glove. And I'm thinking some of the first apps for PlayStation VR to use this are going to be the new porn apps.
All right, that's pretty quick assumptions. Squeezing them boobies, right?
Nothing to say, bro.
That's what it's all for. Squeezing the boobies.
How about, you know what would be cool, though, is to get a glove that had haptic feedback.
Oh,
right, so when you reach out and touch something, it actually feels like you're touching it.
That's
I don't know
that
with
the first prototype.
Oh, there it is! There it is! Oh man!
This is the first prototype of it. Just to let you guys know, in case you didn't know, it's pretty cool. You know, you just press buttons like this. It's actually a brand new feature. So I hope it succeeds with the VR.
That thing hardly fits on your hand.
I never tightened it. Like, you see?
Hector, can I ask you a question, quick?
Yes, sir.
Just how old are you exactly?
That's so
good. All right, I'm hanging up on Robbie.
Good answer.
It sounds like the guys, you know, Sony is going to go full force with the VR thing. I don't think they're going to half-ass this. I think they know by looking at what happened to the PlayStation Vita, PlayStation Move, that if they don't get 100% behind this thing, it's going to be dead in the water.
Man, so, I could go for it, though. I mean, if it has haptic feedback, imagine, like, you, like, reach out and you grab, you know, a ball, and then you throw the ball, and, like, when you release it, you can feel the ball leave your hand. What if you grab a gun, and you could feel that gun in your hand, you could feel the trigger? Like, imagine how cool that kind of technology could be. Jesus, I don't know if that's what it's going to be, but
it's important.
It does.
It's very important to add this because, all right, the one feature you're trying to go for realism, a lot of these people have no hands and stuff like that because of finger movements. So when you add gloves and stuff like that, you get the finger movements for certain things, and that can add a whole nother complexity to the game. So if you're holding like a gun or something like that and you're pulling the trigger, now it actually feels more real because you actually see your own hand pulling the trigger. You actually, which is not a good example, that's a bad example, but you know what I mean. Like, you actually feel like the whole game is real.
Yeah, you can do like a puzzle game where you gotta like stick your finger in a Dutch dyke and like plug up the holes. You know, make sure it's not leaking.
Or porn up. Yeah, you could do lots of things.
Well, when you said stick your finger in a hole, I'm like, yeah, I guess.
You guys don't get into that too much. Robbie's only 19. That's one of the pros and cons of being 19, Robbie.
Yeah.
Canada. Oh, sorry.
I'll tell you, I don't know. I'm excited for the future of VR. I don't know if I'm going to – a year ago, if you asked me, I would have said I'm going to buy into this like as soon as it hits the market. Right now, I'm a little more conservative about it just because like I want to be there for the beginning, but I'm not sure that the beginning is going to be any good, you know?
I got a question. Now, you were building
– I'm sorry. What were you saying, Beasley?
No problem. Breyer was building a PC centered around the ability to play Oculus Rift. Have you given up on that dream?
It was a dual-purpose PC. The goal was to set up a streaming PC that would also be ready for VR. But I feel like the computer I have right now is doing the job fine for streaming. I would like a more powerful PC. I feel like the stream would be just a little bit better. But it's not a big enough jump that I feel like I need to get into it. But as I wait, those graphic cards just get better and better and better.
Yeah.
You know, so like I'm going to buy into this at the last second, I think, is the goal here. And if Sony does it well enough, I might not do it at all.
That's what I'm thinking.
I don't feel the need to spend $3,000 on a PC, which, you know, frankly, will drive me insane.
Well, see, I just spent $1,600 on this. I don't want to do any PC upgrading for a while, you know, a couple of years. This thing is great for rendering videos. That's really what I got it for. It has a pretty decent graphics card. The games look great. I can run all games on high settings. You know, it works for what I want. And the PS4 has the power built into it to run its own VR. And that breakout box for the PlayStation VR, a lot of people don't know what that thing is used for. It's actually for the TV. It's not for the PS4, for the headset. The PlayStation 4 actually will be doing all the onboard processing for the virtual reality world going to the headset. The breakout box is taking the signal from the headset, transferring it to your TV so the people in your living room or whoever's around you.
I didn't know that. That's awesome. So that's I can still record gameplay.
Yes. That's what the breakout box is for.
Oh, that's awesome news.
Question. Yeah. I like to go around and ask everyone, what do you think is the appropriate price, like the real price that it's going to be? And then do you think there's going to be tiers, like different levels, and what you think they're going to get in each level? Like, so like for bundles and stuff for the VR, like I personally think a good price for every, like a starter bundle, should be $300. And I think that's a basic bundle is $300. And I just say that's minimum with like one Move stick and, you know, just the VR headset. You know, I think a good bundle right there.
Okay. So do you think that the breakout box is going to be optional?
That's part of it. I think that's gonna have to be included no matter what. I think that because that actually optimizes visually too. So like that you need that in order to transport it for the headset too. So you still need it regardless. They said that helps give it power because it doesn't have enough power to transport from the PlayStation 4 to output to the headset. So you still need that to output power anyway. So you're still going to need that device regardless on that part. But you're right. It's mostly used for the additional part for the TV to share. But I don't know. I think $300. I'm hoping if that's the smart way, the basic model, and then you can entice people to get the higher model because.
What's going to be the difference between the higher one and the lower one?
Like I think you know.
Come
like
with a game,
said,
maybe.
Games also. You're talking about another move because some games you need two movements. Gloves. If we're talking about now gloves and stuff like that, that could be even higher tier that has everything. There could be like a super bundle that includes every single thing. You know,
if they have a glove that's not a pack-in with the helmet, the glove is doomed.
Mm-hmm. Totally.
Yeah.
So you think it has to be the original? It has to be right away, the glove?
Yeah, I mean, otherwise you're not going to develop for it, right? If you don't know what's going to be there, you're not going to develop for it.
Well,
it
depends on the type
of game.
It
has to be ready.
Because some games are not going to use, like, the hand movements. So, like, that's the thing. I still think it's going to be dependent on the game anyway, right? So, like, that's the thing. Like, it's going to be dependent on the type of game. So, if you're a person who knows that you're not going to play a certain game that use hands, then you don't need
Baby, you gotta
what
have
game
those
wouldn't
hands.
You want that hand though? Right?
Why
like,
wouldn't
even
you
a driving
want
game,
hand
you
movements?
Want the
yeah.
driving game so you could like you know give the middle finger to the guy.
You know, a perfect game for the VR hand would be a Star Wars game. Using
yep,
the Force,
it would
using
be
different movements.
Absolutely. That Star Wars insane. Game, a boxing game, awesome. A juggling game.
I love you
golf
for 3 1
golfing game, like everything. You'd want it for everything because if you're in VR, you want to be able to reach out and touch stuff. Hmm.
Yeah, I'm excited for it now.
Robbie, on stream, really?
He was doing this too. Sorry.
Come on, Robbie.
You got to censor that now.
Oh, what? Because I'm not an old man. He gets away with it? All right.
So personally, guys, when it comes to PlayStation VR, let's stay on subject. Shut up, Robbie. if we're going to talk about the price of what the PlayStation VR is, I don't think that they can reasonably price it above the cost of the console. I don't think that that's realistic 100%. At all.
What's the cost of the console right now?
$349 is the cost of the PS4.
I think now, $400, you can't go above that. Because the problem is, too, people are going to see this as a peripheral. You can't have it more powerful than the system that's running it. Even though this is pretty much like it's a new console launch. It honestly is for VR. You can't have it more expensive because people are going to see that.
Thank you for hijacking my thoughts, sir.
That's what they said about Move, too, and look how that turned out. That's what they said about Xbox Kinect. Look how that turned out. Fuck that. Yeah.
Okay. I think, honestly, a reasonable price would be somewhere between $249 and $349. It is premium hardware. I mean, I'm thinking that this is going
to be... I just don't
know
if they can hit that without taking major losses.
Yeah, that's a problem. This price point is really the biggest struggle for VR right now.
Well, what is Sony's number one revenue... What is their number one source of revenue right now? PlayStation.
Yeah.
So I think that, I mean, look at Xbox. They're taking a loss every time they sell a console. Sony at least is making profit on each console, and their consoles are the number one source of revenue, so they might take a loss for the VR bundles to get them out there because the PS4 is actually their number one breadwinners right now.
Yeah.
So in order to support the PS4, they might take a loss on the VR headset just to kind of enhance their number one avenue of profit.
But I think that's why they have to go with different tiers of bundles. And I know you may think it's going to kill them, but I think that's going to entice people to get the bigger bundle, or even later they'll buy an accessory, which is going to help them out either way. So I think that's why like there's all these peripherals, and there's going to be more because there's going to be other third-party companies that are going to be creating things for it too. There's already companies that are creating stuff for the Oculus Rift.
Yeah, Nyko's got to make a cooler for it. You know,
cooler. What? Is your VR headset getting hot on your head? There are cooling fans.
Let's cool down for you. X gonna give it to you.
Well, even the lower tier though, not too nerdy. The lower tier is going to still be $350, $300.
Yeah,
you know,
so
think about what you got. You got this breakout box. It's going to do all the processing to your television. You got the VR headset, which you know isn't going to be cheap. Okay, and you got a Move controller, which really, I guess, would be optional. But the three of those, that's going to be at least $300. There's no way it's not.
Yeah. Well, the Move controller is cheap, right?
Move controller is cheap, but they're going to somehow try to make it new.
I thought it was just going to be the same one as they had with the PS3.
I already have one. So that's the thing. If they try to sell,
I think it'd be smart to just use the same one because you can use those with PS4 right now.
Especially that manufacturing cost would be so much cheaper than it was when it first came out. It's got to be way cheaper now.
I just hope Sony doesn't screw it up and do some, like, you know, some
don't fuck it up.
Corporate America crap. You know, like, imagine they come out and they
proprietary. They do that.
They come out and they be like, okay, well, we're gonna give you a basic one, right? But it's only gonna have like a 2-foot cord. If you want one to walk further,
no.
It's gonna be like a 4-foot cord.
That is totally. Oh my god, that's totally what they did. And you can never replace that cord, right? It's hardwired in.
That's fucking Sony with their proprietary shit.
Oh, you can't walk too far away from.
I'm right on the TV. Look.
That's probably what's gonna happen. So.
If you think about it, though, it shouldn't be that expensive, right? You got the breakout box. How much can that breakout box cost? It's got a power supply and probably like the processor doesn't have to be that powerful to just transfer it from 3D to 2D and send it out to your TV.
I would have to say that's probably going to be like sort of like one of those devices, any of those streaming devices. So it might be the cost of
like an Elgato kind of thing?
Elgato, like Amazon Fire TV, all those devices, okay. Are small, like streaming devices. It's got to be one of those prices. You know what I mean? I would say like around the $100 mark, maybe a little less.
Guys, I'm actually on the site now. Richard Marks is the guy who's working on PlayStation VR. He said that basically, if you wanted to show it on the TV won't even accept the signal from the VR headset. That's exactly what the breakout box is for. It does all the processing from the headset to the television.
It's not like this thing's running like a high-end i7 processor. I'm guessing it'd be like a fairly cheap processor to buy. It's not like a mega. I mean, considering what they could do with a cell phone chip from 5 years ago, I'm assuming that this thing is pretty cheap.
Because hearing it, that's what solved their problem also, because they didn't have enough power to power the device, the headset. And that because you can't, especially the USB ports, you can't charge it up like that. There's no unit on the PS4 that could do that. But, I mean, that's what they're saying. They'll be pretty interesting, the price range. I know that's the reason why they're waiting, but I don't know. I'm kind of curious to see, because the minute they say six anything, boos, and are going to happen, and they just lost.
What about 500? What if they hit $500?
They still can't. They know that 500 is too much. If even 400 is going to sound like
it's
too much.
400,
I think 400 is actually where they will just barely make profit, and I think that's where 400 be with them barely making profit.
400 is,
I understand that.
Now, but you keep in mind, though, not too nerdy, if they sell it for $400, it's going to have killer apps. They've got to prove to people that it's worth people buying it.
Well, there's going to be people that buy it anyway. You know, the first adopters are going to jump on this thing like crazy.
They're going to do it regardless. And like, I don't know. Maybe Sony might come out with that little scheme that, you know, there's only limited in the beginning, and it's going to be sold out right away.
Right, they can advertise it at $300, but when you go to the store, you actually want to buy the $400.
Yeah.
Like when you go get your oil changed?
Or when you bought the original Xbox 360. Remember, if you bought the arcade version of Xbox 360, it came with, like, nothing.
No.
There was, like, you couldn't even play games because it didn't come with a hard drive or anything.
Nothing.
But they could advertise it at, like, $300 less than a PS3.
Yeah.
Yeah, it'll be interesting to see, because like I think all eyes are on Sony, because they're the only ones that, you know, console is where everyone plays, right, for the most part. And you got PC gamers out there that are going to get it, but like seriously, the console is where everyone's going to look at it first. That's what's really going to make it out in the public, is when the people find out about it. See, a lot of people every day don't know about it, so they don't play games or anything like that. But once they hear someone like Sony or something that brings it out, they're going to know about that. And they're going to hear that, virtual reality is out like that. So it can make or break it just like that.
Yeah, my prediction is this, guys, and this is what I'm going to stick to. I predict that the PlayStation VR is going to hit $299, and Sony may take a loss, but they're going to count on the early adopters buying those games, and that's where they're going to make their money back.
I say $349. I don't think I can go much higher.
I would like both prices, to be honest. I don't mind either one of those prices. I think that, like, Sony, like, don't forget, Sony's going to help Oculus, too. The reason why it's important, because Oculus knows damn well if Sony screws this crap up, it screws up the Oculus, too, because a lot of people are going to be turned off from buying Oculus, too. That's going to be even more expensive. So that's why, like, you're got to work together in that part, because if one person screws up, this whole VR thing is completely over. Gone for another 20 years, and then they're going to try it again.
Like, yeah, remember the mid-90s? That thing came and went too, and then here we are again.
Question, do you remember the mid-90s?
Yeah, what the hell are you talking about? Weren't you born in the mid-90s?
I was like two when the mid-90s were
born. I learned in history class.
George Washington in the mid-90s.
I don't remember that.
See, that shit can go both ways, Robbie. You always dissing those old farts, and then it gets reversed on it.
Hey, I get called an old fart constantly in a Discord hangout. It's pretty frustrating.
By who? People in diapers? What the hell?
No, just they're not even that much younger than me. I'm just the old guy, apparently, because I'm an adult now.
It doesn't matter. Like, if you hang out with five guys and you're the oldest by a month, you get called the old one.
You're the old man, yeah. That's how I feel. I'm always called the old fart and stuff. I'm like, sure. I mean, all right. Compared to you guys.
You don't want to be the youngest, and you want to be the oldest.
No. I prefer to be the youngest.
I'm glad I'm the youngest. I mean, this situation, yeah.
You know, because when you're the youngest, you've had very little sexual experience, had very little life experience.
Well, you just go right down.
You can't grow any facial hair.
Is this a gaming podcast?
Hey guys, relax. I gotta be in a good mood. I'm getting ready to watch Rocky win the Oscar. Okay, so that's what I'm waiting for.
Oh, is that tonight? Are the Oscars tonight?
Yeah,
that'll be the second Oscar that a Rocky movie wins, right?
It'll be the first Oscar Sylvester Stallone ever won.
Stallone, yeah.
If he wins it, I don't know. I mean,
Stallone.
I hope he wins it, and I have a feeling Leonardo DiCaprio is going to lose again. You know what I mean? I saw a meme that said, like, what if Leonardo loses again, and 30 years from now, there's a movie that's about him, and the guy that plays Leonardo wins. And I was like,
that sucks. I don't know if the game is released yet, but there's a game in development at least where you are Leonardo DiCaprio, and you're trying to help him win. That's the whole purpose of the game.
Yeah, what?
It's a real thing, I swear. I've seen it online. There's a game where you're Leonardo DiCaprio and you're trying very, very hard to win.
We related to gaming just like that, guys. That was quick. Related right to gaming just like that. Awesome. Good work. Good tag team right there.
That's how you do it. Beastly thoughts, baby.
We did it.
All right, let's wrap this one up. Beastly, what are you up to this week?
Oh, man. I'm going to be playing some games, and I'm going to be uploading my 2016 gaming setup. You guys look forward to that.
I'm looking forward to that. That's coming out tonight, right?
You said
that's
coming out tonight. It's not just games, but it's basically the den that every man wishes they could be in and play games in. Uh-huh. Because not only do I have all the games, I got a hot chick playing next to me. It's fucking
nice.
Win-win, man.
That's a plus. That's a plus.
Yeah.
I got nothing like that.
Oh, poor Robbie.
I love gaming setups. I absolutely love them. Robbie, what are you up to this week?
Probably playing some more Far Cry Primal. Be doing that. Uh-huh. Might put out a video this week, too. It's been a while. I think I'll be doing that. But yeah, I'm looking forward to a lot more gaming, and it should be good.
Are you done with CSGO? Tired of the same old shit?
I got so sick and tired of everyone using the op sniper rifle. I just got so sick of that. But the game's still a lot of fun. I should jump back into it.
Damn it, I got him back. All right.
Yeah? There you go. Sold me.
Not too dirty?
I will be releasing, finally, unboxing videos. I was just working on like the format and everything. I'm trying to improve the way my channel looks. So that's why I've been changing everything. Same thing for Twitch. I improved all, everything in Twitch. So I'm going to be live streaming this week. You should definitely go check it out if you like Blade and Soul. If you're not used to MMOs, it's a different type of MMO. The combat system is a lot of fun. And also, yeah, super hot. I'm going to be playing that, live streaming that as well. So definitely check that out. And yeah, that's pretty much it. So.
And that's going to be it. Help me out with the address again. Twitch.tv/... Not too nerdy, right?
Not too nerdy.
No ENT, this one.
Yeah, just not too nerdy. Very simple on that one.
I'll try and remember to put a link in the description of the video.
Guys, did the stream freeze for you? I mean, we're ending, so it's not a huge deal, but like, is it frozen?
No, not for me.
Everybody sit still.
Okay, good. Mine's frozen. I guess it's fine. All right. We're good.
All right, I'll be playing, I'll be playing Destiny. I still want to get back to damn Tomb Raider. I have not finished that game yet.
Oh, yeah.
And I'm really enjoying it. I just keep running out of time, and Destiny sucks me in like a abusive relationship.
It shouldn't be abusive for you, Briar. You should be enjoying it.
I'll have a chance to play. I'll have a chance to play some Tomb Raider this week. Oh, Iron Banner. Oh, look at that sniper rifle. Oh, look at that. Oh, Crimson Doubles. Oh, I want to play some Crimson Doubles. Oh, you know, it's the weekend. I want to play a little, you know, Trials of Osiris. Ah, I missed another month of Tomb Raider. Another
month. Time flies, doesn't it, Brian?
Yeah, and next month we got The Division coming out, which I'm going to be all over. Like, I'm really hyped for
next
The Division.
Next week, actually.
Is it next week?
Yeah.
Is it downloadable yet? Can we start downloading it yet?
No, it's not preloadable. It should be awfully soon, though. Definitely.
Yeah. Definitely. All right, that'll be fun. I'm gonna be on The Division because, you know, one of the things I love about Destiny is the PvE experience, playing with a group of friends, getting in there and fighting, you know, AI as a team and having a good time doing that. And since there's been such a lack of content in Destiny, I'm really looking forward to bringing that same group of people into The Division and having that same experience. So I'm really looking forward to
it. Oh, someone says in chat, you can preload Division on Xbox One. Thank you.
Oh, awesome. Nice. Thank you, WB Golf. All right, so that's going to wrap it up. I did want to say thank you to new followers. We got Sanin72. Thank you very much. Dayton Line Gamer. The Macho Lewis. That's an awesome name.
Oh,
Laughs with Frank. Thank you to everybody who followed today. Ninja Kitty, I think, is a new follower as well. Ninja Kitty HM, who I think...
She's a friend of mine. Thank you for watching.
Nice. So thank you to everybody.
Female friend, Robbie. Woo!
Stop it.
Stop it. Stop it.
Ninja Kitty, good job.
All right, so I think that's going to do it. Okay. Anybody else got anything they want to say before we sign off?
Thanks for watching, everybody. Had a lot of fun. Yeah, great end, well, beginning to my week.
Yep. Don't forget, look forward to that new Sony VR glove.
Whoa. Bye, guys. See you later.
All right. I think we are... Oh, yeah. It just locked up.
Is it... You're done? You stopped it?
Yeah. No, the stream locked.
All right. Right there. I was going to say, also, what you could do... do you know how to make it so it's announcement, it pops up something?
Like on Twitter?
On
no,
Twitch.
He's talking about Twitch. When someone follows you, so they pop up.
Oh yeah, go to twitchalerts.com.
You should do it on here for the show, because someone like adds you or something on there, you could alert on the bottom.
We can all say something at the same time. That'll make more and more people want to follow.
So you guys would be able to see it.
We can hear it though.
Wait, they can't see it.
You guys would be able to see it.
But will we be able to hear it? Or maybe you could give us a cue, and we could all like make some kind of crazy sound.